knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
Artifacts are one of the most important data points in archaeology. They can range from 18th century garbage to gold from elaborate royal tombs. In fact, some of the most important artifacts are trash. While studying exotic artifacts give you hints about the lives of elite people in past societies, trash, also called refuse in archaeology, lets you see how the everyday person lived. What did people use for tools? What did they eat? What did they do at home? Material culture is found as much in our garbage as it is in our temples and tombs. As we mentioned earlier, an object over 50 years old is defined as an artifact. Archaeologists use artifacts and their context to form hypotheses about our ancient past. Being able to properly identify artifacts is very important in archaeological research. Not including an artifact in a study due to a misinterpreted identification can be to the detriment of a study, as is including an artifact that shouldn't be there. Analyzing artifacts is critical to creating typologies and a variety of other research methods that archaeologists utilize. Let's take a look at how to identify and analyze some of the most common artifact types. Stone tools are some of the most common artifact types since they preserve well. In archaeology, stone tools and artifacts made when creating them are called lithics, coming from the Greek word for stone. While stone tools have been used throughout human history, we will mainly be looking at them in a prehistoric context. Lithic studies is an entire subfield of archaeology, so we'll just go over the basics here. One of the most prominent types of lithic artifact is a point. While commonly called arrowheads by the general public, this term isn't used in archaeology. This is because it implies something about the tool, the idea that it was the head of an arrow. However, many of the points called arrowheads are spear or dart points. Archaeologists simply refer to lithic artifacts that come to a point as points. Points that would have been placed on a shaft of wood and shot or thrown are called projectile points. The process of creating a point is called napping. Not just any rock can be napped. Actually, the vast majority of rock types don't meet important criteria. Most importantly, a rock must be able to easily break in predictable ways when a force is applied. The rock also must be hard enough to withstand being used as a point, instead of breaking before it's able to lodge itself into a target. By far, the most common rocks used in napping contain microcrystalline quartz, namely chert and flint. Another rock used is obsidian. To nap, a napper will strike a large piece of flint with a percussive tool, historically made from antler. This large, unworked piece of flint is called a core. A single core often produces several points. Pieces are broken from this core, which are called flakes. These flakes, taken from the core, called primary flakes, are further worked. Flakes are broken off of primary flakes until the general shape of the point is reached. At this stage, the point is often worked with a sharp tool to serrate and thin the edge. The making of a single point will often produce more lithic refuse than the point itself. While points can be easy enough to identify as a point, let's learn to identify lithic refuse, as large quantities of lithic refuse are one of the best ways to diagnose prehistoric settlements. Flint and other nappable stones crack and break into smaller pieces through a variety of natural phenomena, so how could we differentiate it from this? Flakes have several characteristics because of how they were broken, which lets us identify them. At the top of the flake will be a flattened area. This is the striking platform, where the napper applied the percussive force to break the flake off the point. One side of the flake will be mostly smooth, where the flake was against the point or core. On this smooth side, directly below the platform, is a bump called the bulb of percussion. This is created by the force of the striking platform being hit. Several other factors exist to help determine if a piece of flint is an artifact, but these are the ones that we will discuss. Now that we know how to identify flakes and points, let's learn some basic analyses of them. First, as with all artifacts, knowing where in the world the lithic artifact was found is the single most important datum. Points can be broken down into two broad categories, spear points and projectile points. Projectile points need to be attached to a shaft and must be aerodynamic enough to fly through the air. Projectile points can be further broken down into two categories, dart points and arrow points. Dart points were attached to throwing spears, or darts. These were either thrown just as a spear or with the assistance of a tool called the atlatl. The atlatl was an Ice Age invention that let people throw darts much harder and farther. Arrow points are projectile points that were attached to an arrow and shot from a bow. The main way to distinguish between these two is size. Lithic arrow points are usually no larger than 3 centimeters, as larger points would weigh down an arrow. Projectile points can be further described based on 2 characteristics, notch and stem. The notch refers to large grooves near the base of a projectile point where it was tied to the shaft. Where this notch is on the point can be described as well, dividing them into groups like side-notched, corner-notched, and basal-notched. Stemmed points can be identified by a skinny extension of material on the base of the point. A stem can be described as being contracting, straight, or expanding. It's also possible that a point has neither a notch nor a stem, and this is an important descriptive characteristic for projectile points. Let's analyze a real point. Suppose the point was found in Tennessee, USA, and measures 5 centimeters in length. Notice the cut areas near the bottom. This makes the point notched rather than stemmed. The notches aren't in the base or corner of the point, so it's a side-notched point. Using an archaeological database of typologies, we would place it into the Big Sandy Point typology. This tells us a lot about the point. We now know it was created around 5,000 to 10,000 BP and is part of a napping tradition that spans several states in the eastern United States. If this point was found in situ, we could also date other artifacts and features in the same layer. This was how the typology's date range was created, by finding dozens of examples of the point in layers that could be dated, since we can't just date lithic material. While this descriptive analysis only works for points, another type of analysis, sourcing, can be done for all lithics. Sourcing is done by finding where the material from a lithic artifact was gathered. This can help us understand material exchange in the prehistoric world. By describing exact coloration, banding, hardness, luminosity, molecular composition, and several other factors, we can often find what outcropping a piece of obsidian, chert, or flint came from. Some flints are more suited to being napped, and thus were widely distributed. Check the geology series to review many methods of identifying minerals. These same methods are used, but with greater precision, to describe a flint. Then the flint is compared with the inventory of raw flints to find where it originated. These identification and analysis methods have given us a good idea of how to spot a lithic point and the basics of descriptive analysis. However, many other lithics exist besides points. Another large group of lithic tools are ground stone tools. Ground stone lithics were made by modifying larger hard rocks into tools. Several artifact types fall into this category. This includes stone axes, grinding stones, celts, chisels, and hoes. While each of these artifacts were used differently, their creation was similar. A hard stone that doesn't break or fracture would be chosen. This can be granite, limestone, or many others. The stone would then be ground with sand or another stone until a desirable shape was reached. Most ground stones will have a polished exterior and can be identified this way. To differentiate between rounded river rocks, we would look for wear on the surface of the artifact where the artifact was used. This can sometimes be difficult to identify, as many ground stones are broken when found. Still, a smoothed, polished edge can be looked for to identify the material. Ground stones can be broken into many types of artifacts, and those types can be further sorted into typologies in a similar manner as points. However, this is outside the scope of this series for now. Other lithic types exist as well, but they are less common in prehistoric archaeology than points and ground stones. Let's move forward and look at another important artifact, ceramics.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.